Hi everyone, back here at Rutgers NJIT for another broadcast. So for those of you who haven't been watching, we are broadcasting through the Scicomm Monday handle, even though it's not Monday. This is a special occasion, so we're live on Tuesday. This is Tuesday, right?
Tuesday.
Yes, it is Tuesday. Yes. And so make sure that you're following along with the Rutgers NJIC or NJIT hashtag, Scicomm hashtag, because we're posting everything under that particular hashtag. And then if you have any questions after the broadcast, feel free to also tweet me at my personal handle, so that way we can get all of your questions answered with everything. So with that, I'm going to introduce our next PhD student, Rebecca Panko, and she does a lot of really cool work with plants and their evolution. But why don't you tell us a little bit about your background so everyone kind of knows like how you got to where you are now.
Sure. So great to be here. Thanks for having me. I'm excited. I have a really interesting background. My parents were both national park rangers growing up, so I actually lived on Liberty Island as a child and then moved right outside the Everglades where I spent most of my time. And so
that's pretty cool. I'm jealous.
It was really interesting. We would go camping for Thanksgiving. It was a very interesting life. So from an early age, you know, they're always pointing out different ecological things changing, and my dad is very into geology, so always pointing out evolution of things. And so I was always a science-y kid, and then took some time off to figure out really what I wanted to do, and then when I went back to my into undergrad, I decided I wanted to get a PhD, and it had to be something with plants. And originally, I was planning on going into botany, because that seemed very interesting to me. And I'm still very interested in plant morphology and actually teach a lot of plant morphology and plant evolution classes here. But it became very clear that being a botanist, I was actually going to be spending quite a bit of time in the herbarium and maybe not outside as much as I'd like to be. And so I switched gears and thought, you know, maybe I'm really more interested in plant evolution and ecological dynamics, and particularly urban plants. Having grown up early on in New York City, and then I live in Brooklyn now, where I've been the last 14 years, you know, cities are very dynamic places. Urban areas are expanding very rapidly. We currently have more than 50% of the world's population living in urban environments. And it's projected that in 2050, the UN projects that we're going to have about 6.4 billion people living in urban areas.
And wow. Just to give that's a lot of people.
Give some perspective, right now our global population is about 7 billion.
So basically, almost like the current total world population now is going to be in cities. Wow,
that's what they project.
Wow.
So plants in urban environments are really impacted already, and considering the exponential human population growth that we're expecting and the increase in urbanization that we're expecting, I'm really interested in how to make cities smarter to preserve wild plant populations, because we do put a lot of money into our ornamental plants and our formal plantings, but at the end of the day, not every city has the resources financially to manage every green space. Mm-hmm. And understanding how plants evolve to the very unique urban syndromes, such as increased habitat fragmentation, which isn't unique to urban areas, but it happens very quickly in urban areas, and then also increased abiotic stress. So you thinking, for example, in the northeastern United States, we have things like increased soil salinity due to de-icing salt application every year. We have increased impervious surface, so water cannot go into the soil so readily, and that increases flooding events and also drought events. So these are things that really impact plants, and we do have a lot of recent studies showing that different taxa can and are evolving to urbanization.
Great. So we had a viewer coming in from Russia, so to let everyone know, by the way, hello Russia.
Hi.
It's great to have you here. We're currently live in Newark, New Jersey, and we're just right across the way from New York City, which actually is one of the places that you do your research. I'm going to give everyone a quick view so you can see how close we are. If you look through there, all those really big tall buildings in the background there, that is New York City. So that's how close we are to study sites and to some really
really great.
Thanks. So let me get the camera back there so you can see us again. As much as awesome as New York City is, I'm sure you'd rather like look at us than
hopefully.
Yeah. Although I have to admit, like as I was flying in, I was taking many pictures of, you know, New York City because it was the first time I actually saw it like in person
it's
versus
impressive.
On TV. So I was like, I was being that cheesy tourist of like confidence. So, tell us about where like actually in the city your study sites are. Like, is it just like throughout the entire city? Like, break it down a little bit for us.
Right. So in order to figure out or look at how plants are evolving in urban areas, I have to look at them within and outside of urban areas. So I've picked a plant which is called shepherd's purse, which you've probably walked by a million times. If you're a plant person, you probably are like, oh, that's a weed. And if you're a non-plant person, you probably didn't notice. But they are, it's the second most common weed worldwide. Very, very small, very, very cute seed pods that look like little hearts. And but they tend to be everywhere that humans are. So what I'm planning to do and what I'm working on right now is seed collections across three transects. And the transects run from the core of Manhattan, so 42nd Street, and 60 kilometers out east, west, and north of that. So that's about 60 kilometers, roughly around 34 miles, give or take. So some sites
could
even be here.
But why don't you explain what a transect is to everyone? So
sure.
For some folks who might not know what it is.
Absolutely. So a transect is essentially a line that you place in an area that you are looking to collect data from. So for example, my transects run along an urban rural gradient. And the way I'm defining urban is via impervious surface. So there's different ways to define urbanization and human population density, sometimes is one housing density. I'm using impervious surface because I feel like that is very relevant to plants because they're in the ground. And so my transects will actually run across a gradient of impervious surface. So in the urban core, you're looking at, you know, 80 to 100% impervious surface, depending on the pixel size.
A little then, different than my green space over in West Michigan.
Yeah, so, yeah. A lot. Yeah. And then at the ends of the gradient, I'll have impervious surface that'll be maybe a little closer to that kind of a green space.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, like, how, like, I know you're saying 60 kilometers, so, like, about, like, how far, like, outside of, like, the city would those transects take you?
Right,
so like, if someone was to, like, okay, you're going from, like, Brooklyn to, you know, the next borough over, like, where does that, like, actually, like, end up so people can, like, see it in their minds
yeah,
a little better?
Yeah, so the western transect goes from Midtown Manhattan until Morristown, which Tony probably talked about in the previous one, Morristown, New Jersey. The eastern one will go out to about Hempstead, Long Island. So it's hard to find an appropriate transect that has enough of that differences in impervious surface because, you know, there are we're pretty heavily urban area in general. You know, even the UN considers from Newark to the boroughs as being one unit.
Okay.
Yep. And so in our Newark, New York, Newark area, we have about 21 million people.
Yeah, it's actually, I have to admit, like, having driven through, like, last night and today, like, with Kathleen, who's, you know, the PhD student that's hosting me, it was like, it kind of doesn't really surprise me because there are a lot of people around here.
Yes, there's a lot of people. Yeah. But that's another reason why I'm so passionate about urban ecology in general and teaching a new people about urban ecology because, you know, as more and more people move into cities are going to be the only places that people see plants. And, you know, we need people to see plants in order to care about plants and in order to care about environmental issues in general. It's a real easy way. You're just walking to your subway in the morning and you can say, hey, there's shepherd's purse, there's other species as well. So
yeah, so how important. Yeah, how common are they around where, like, I mean, like, say, like, if you're walking from your apartment down to the subway into your work, like, how many, like, plants would you see along the way that would be shepherd's purse? Like, I mean, is it a fairly common weed?
It's really, really common. I think you would be hard-pressed to take a walk even just a few city blocks and not find some shepherd's purse.
Okay.
Yeah. And it's interesting. It's a really cool plant in the sense where, so birds do eat it, so it can be bird dispersed. But one plant individual can make, so there's about 20 seeds per seed pod, and one plant individual can have multiple generations a year, and each time have well over 30 seed pods. So you're looking at thousands and thousands of seeds from one individual a year. And on top of that,
that's pretty impressive.
Yeah, the seeds are really long-lived, so they can, if the conditions aren't right for them, they can kind of hang out until conditions are right.
So like they just stay in the soil for a number of years, and then the conditions are perfect, and then they, you know, bloom out or grow.
Yeah.
I guess a technical term. I'm a wildlife ecologist.
Then yes, germinate.
Thank you. I did teach botany for a semester. That's really sad that I can't remember. It was a while ago. So.
And fun fact about shepherd's purse too is that the seeds are actually considered semi-carnivorous because when they get wet, they exude mucus, and that mucus is actually able to not only stick to things to help it get vectored, but also trap insects, which it then digests to help the seed germinate, which never knew
so
existed.
So it's kind of like a Venus flytrap kind of thing, or
pseudo.
Wow.
I never knew that was even a thing.
Yeah, I had no clue that there was a seed that did it. Like I knew of like the adult plants that would do that. Yeah. Like if you call them adult, did you call them adults?
Mature. Or,
yes, there we go. I'm coming out for my wildlife side of things. So.
You can call them adults.
Yes.
It's okay.
But it's that's really cool. So like. Do all of them do that, or is there just like it happens to be opportunistic? You know, if there happens to be an insect there, like is it that they're constantly, all of them are always producing that mucus, and then if an insect happens to go by, then they'll digest it. Then
it only secretes the mucus when the seed gets moistened.
Okay.
It's something that's called myxospermy, and basically it probably serves multiple functions: one, to allow it to stick to the surface of the soil; two, to potentially trap insects, which it can later use for germination purposes; and then three, to vector, so it could stick more readily to your bottom of your shoe. Then it and then you can take it down the block.
Right.
Yeah.
So like how like far out do they disperse, you know, per se? Like is it, you know, just like maybe like a block or two, or like are you seeing seeds that could, you know, go from here to the next state over if like a bird happened to pick it up? Like is that possible?
That's totally possible. And like I said, so this is a weed that is considered, at least in around 2006, was considered the second most prolific weed worldwide, which it originated from Western Asia, Eastern Europe, it's an allotetraploid, which means that it is kind of like two species in one.
There's your word for the day, everyone.
Allotetraploid.
Say that 5 times fast. I dare you. I'm not going to do it.
So, it started there, and now it's worldwide. It's most likely vectored the most via humans, but I'm sure also bird dispersed as well.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yep, so to remind everyone, we're currently live from the Rutgers / NJIT campus, so this is New Jersey Institute of Technology campus. We're technically on the New Jersey Institute side of the campus, but it's also, we have a bunch of Rutgers folks here with us, and we're talking with Rebecca Panko, who's a PhD student at Rutgers, about her plant evolution ecology
extravaganza.
Yeah, that's the perfect word for it. Yes, that she's doing based off in New York City, which we can currently see with a nice lovely view here, which is making it hard for me to like keep paying attention to the broadcast rather than the beautiful view out there. But you guys are all awesome, so we'll pay attention to you. So that's really interesting, like to have a plant that is that wide spread. Like what other plants are similarly widespread, do you know of, like any other like big ones? Like I know like in our area, Phragmites seems to be like all over the place as a like a really, you know, widespread plant, but I can't say like if it's worldwide spread like shepherd's purse is. So.
Right. I mean, Phragmites has a pretty good distribution in wetland areas. It's very prolific. There's a lot of other global distributed plants. Plantango is one. It's all a weedy species that you think about, you know, hawkweed, dandelion, the things that you're trying to get rid of in your lawn, essentially. Mm-hmm. Those are the ones that they have the biggest impact. It's what's interesting too is like shepherd's purse is not considered invasive.
Okay.
You know, it's everywhere, but it's not considered invasive. And not in New York City. Because there's differences in being non-native and being invasive. So invasive is, it outcompetes other plants. And to basically, in terms of all plants that are non-native, relatively speaking, shepherd's purse really doesn't do that. You know, it occupies places that other plants basically don't want to or can't. Okay.
So it's not necessarily driving out other plants. It's just like you said, taking like maybe those like cracks in the sidewalk kind of places that, you know, other things can't grow. But because it's able to take advantage of that, you find it everywhere then.
Right.
Okay.
Right. It's opportunistic. My point was that it's not really managed. You know, it's not one of those of heavy offenders where people are, you know, sending teams out to eradicate shepherd's purse. You know, there's other ones like Japanese knotweed, which is, do you guys have that up there in waterways?
I haven't particularly had to deal with it myself. It could be up there, but I haven't come across it. But I know I've heard the name so much because I'm so involved with different invasive species, so I can't remember if it actually is in the Great Lakes or if it's just because I've talked to so many different people who study it that like the name is in my head.
Yeah.
So.
But that's a very problematic plant in our area. It was actually planted originally as erosion control, and a lot of our most invasive species, ironically, were planted to serve some sort of ecosystem service. And to be fair, it actually is very good at erosion control. It's just also very good at outcompeting other species, such that you get, you know, huge monocultures of all that you can see is Japanese knotweed. Another one is kutsu.
I don't think we necessarily have it in the Great Lakes,
but it
seems like it's all over the Southeast, if I remember correctly. And it's just like, is that the one that's like growing like a foot a day or like 12 feet a day? It's something like crazy that you just can't believe like
right.
how much it's growing.
Okay. Right. So it, depending on conditions, it can grow that fast a day. And it's something that's been a problem in the South for a very long time. And I actually went to a talk recently at the New York Botanical Garden where the speaker said that it is actually now within the boroughs as well. So it is here in New York City and in our area, which is not good because we already have a lot of plants that we manage, and I don't think that that's even made a blip yet. And unfortunately, because of how fast it grows, well, we kind of need to get on it now before it becomes a big, big blip, I guess, is what you could say.
Yep. So we just had a grad student, Tiana Burke, tune in, and she said that she saw knotweed down in southern Ontario. So it probably is in the greater Michigan area as well, because once something gets in one part of the Great Lakes area, it seems to just go everywhere. So thanks, Tiana, for that information. Definitely appreciate it. And hello to Canada as well. Yay. So, there was a question that came in. What decides if something is native versus non-native? So can you go into that a little
yes.
bit more? Like, how does that decision get made? Is it arbitrary or is it, you know, just like something that scientists made up to quantify, or is it more than that?
So. That is a great question. And it's actually a very controversial topic. So I'm really glad it was asked because I love controversial topics. It's arbitrary. It's completely arbitrary. There's a lot of sociological implications about saying something is native versus non-native. And I don't think that that's always been a very big conversation in the plant world. There are some papers that talk about that. In the United States, it's basically, if it was here prior to the 1700s, it's considered native. And if it was here after that, it's considered non-native. It's completely arbitrary. I mean, in Europe, there's all these different terms you can, you know, an archaeophyte. So it all has to do about when it was officially noticed at a given location, but 100% arbitrary. And I actually don't care for the terms, which I might be getting in trouble saying as a plant person, but
you're talking to an invasive species biologist, right?
No, well,
we love our terms over, like, cause
that, I know.
No, but it definitely is like one of those things. Like, we're constantly trying to like revamp those terms and like get them to like where everyone can agree, because like you said, it is very controversial, and even within the invasive species communities, we're still like trying to decide, okay, what do you define as an invasive species, what do you define as non-native, what do you like, and so on and so forth. And so it's interesting, like, people have some very hardcore opinions about
it. Yes, they do.
So.
And I think it should be pointed out that just because something is native doesn't mean it can't be invasive. So
very true.
That's one thing people get mixed up. They think if it's native, it's good. Mm-hmm. And if it's non-native or exotic, it's bad. And frankly, that's not true. We have tons of native species that are invasive and are problems to other species. And we have plenty of non-native plants that are not a problem. And they actually provide services to pollinators, and they provide other things. Now, I'm not trying to say that there aren't good plants, quote-unquote, and bad plants, quote-unquote. But in terms of native and non-native, that's not necessarily as clear as people make it seem.
Yeah, I think, like, when it comes to, like, you know, say, like, insects, they might call it a pest rather than invasive if it's a native, where it's still invading and causing issues and driving out other native plants and causing that damage, but we don't, like, define that term. And then it makes it more confusing for that non-science public out there to understand when we're trying to, like, talk about, okay, this plant is bad, well, why is it bad? Well, this is it. Well, but you said this with that other thing, and now I'm just all confused and I don't know anymore.
Right.
And
I tend to focus more on the invasiveness of it. Mm-hmm. And, you know, if it is erratic, if it is extirpating or making it such that a certain other plant that is endemic to an area, another term, but, you know, how do we know?
Right.
Mm-hmm. You can't ask a plant how long it's been there, right? So
it doesn't have its little journal right there
right.
that you can read.
Like, how long? Were you here before 1700?
Yes.
But it... it complicates things.
Yeah, sure. It's one of those things too that I find that even if we might see that a particular plant that is native and showing those invasive tendencies, maybe that it's that 100-year cycle or something that it is doing, and we just don't know because while science has been going on for a while, some of these cycles are extremely long, and we might not necessarily notice those, you know, upticks to things that could be part of its natural process.
Right.
And so we still have to keep studying and learning and see what's happening. And
that's a really good point. And that's why cities, I think, are really good. So what you just said reminds me of how different local conditions could actually improve a species' ability to become invasive.
Mm-hmm.
So let's say you have a golf course and you're applying tons of fertilizer to that golf course because you want your grass to look good. Or even you're in agricultural land and you're applying tons of fertilizer. This fertilizer doesn't stay where you put it. So, you know, in that local environment, you could actually be helping a otherwise non-problematic plant become problematic. And it may be even selecting for plants that can deal with that. So that's something that we need to, like, keep in mind as well. And in terms of cities, what I was going to say is, you know, we in the Northeast United States, we have what's called urban heat island effects, where it's about
which I felt that last night when it was still warm. I'm like, should it have been colder? I brought my coat and I never had to put it on.
Right. So. We're on average about, you know, 5 to 10 degrees warmer than even about 10 or 15 miles outside of the city, or maybe a little bit more, 25 miles outside of the city. And so, you know, what do plants need to grow? They need nutrients. Most plants need, you know, a lot of nutrients. They need warm, sunny days in our area. And so if you have longer periods of warmth, you have more growth. You can have maybe a plant that only has one generation in a cooler environment may have multiple generations in a warmer environment. And this is important because, you know, this is part of the reason why we have maybe kudzu now in our area. It was always considered a very southern problem. Mm-hmm. But as temperatures increase, our whole range is becoming warmer and warmer.
Yeah, I mean, this winter alone, it really wasn't much of a winter at all. So.
Right. And so cities are actually really good places. I kind of like to think of them as almost a real life experiment, because they have conditions in cities that actually mirror what we expect to see in light of climate change. So, like, warmer weather and more episodic drought and flooding events, things like that. So if we can understand what plants are doing inside of cities, it might be applicable to different climatological patterns that change over time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So we had a question coming in asking, do plants evolve?
Plants evolve. Yes, they do. And there's recently evidence that plants evolve in response to urbanization. So I should mention what I'm actually looking to quantify how plants evolve. There are some of you may have heard of Hardy Weinberg, but they're basically...
I have, but I'm also a biology grad.
You should Google him. You should Google it. But so Hardy, basically there are processes that can lead to evolution. And most people are familiar with survival of the fittest, right? That's the tagline most people are comfortable with. And that refers to natural selection. So that what that means is this: the individual and therefore the population, the individuals that will help the species evolve will be those that are being directly impacted by their environment. So if I'm a plant, I'm able to make more seeds than another plant over here because of the environment, how I can handle the environment. That's your natural selection or your survival of the fittest. But evolution doesn't always happen that way. There are other ways that evolution can occur. And one of those ways is something called genetic drift. Genetic drift is random. So natural selection, not random, right? If it's too hot, I can't make seeds. There you go, no seeds. That's not random. But genetic drift is random. So let's take a urban example. I have plants, a plant population. They're perfectly adapted and fine at living in the urban environment, right? They can make tons of seeds. They're really happy. They're very fit. But then imagine you have some building construction that just wipes them out. That's random. Has nothing to do with the plant's fitness. Mm-hmm. It just has to do with...
Yeah, it was a great plant. It just... Bad luck.
Bad luck, right? And so over time, you can be removing randomly both deleterious alleles, but also beneficial alleles, and also alleles that don't even make a difference. And if you have a smaller population, the effects of those random processes impacts more readily, because you have less individuals, and then as one or two individuals are lost, either even due to natural selection or genetic drift, the allele frequencies of that population over time can change, can evolve, but not via natural selection. So I'm interested in yes, plants evolve, and I'm interested in quantifying which of these processes has a larger impact on plant populations, wild plant populations in urban environments. Is it the natural selection? So is it the amount of stress, the soil salinity that they're dealing with, the drought, the warmer weather? Is it this? Is it that? Or is it completely random due to genetic drift? Because wild plant populations in urban environments are smaller on average than others. So the processes of genetic drift can happen. A really interesting study came out in December by McPherson et al. And they actually found, there's another weedy species, Trifolia repens, but it's a violet.
Oh, okay.
And they found evidence in 3 out of 4 cities that within, closer to the urban core, the species no longer exhibited this trait that helped prevent herbivory. And so there's a few reasons why they said that this could have happened, but part of that could be that there is less insect herbivory in urban areas. But their paper was really exciting because we've seen urban evolution happening in different species. We've seen it in white-footed mice, where urban populations of white-footed mice express genes for heavy metal tolerance.
Oh, interesting. Yeah, that would be a good trait to have.
Right?
Yeah.
And even in spiders, these orb spiders, they found that they have evolved to build their nests. They're nocturnal. They build their nests near artificial light sources. And that's a trait that was confirmed even in lab-reared individuals that had never experienced light before.
Yeah, which you guys have plenty of light here, because we were out in the middle of the night and I did not need my headlamp. And
light
I was
pollution.
Like, this should not be possible. I should be like barely able to see in front of me even with my headlamp. And it was like, I could clearly see everything.
Oh, yeah.
And I was like, wow.
When it snows in the wintertime, it's eerie because the sky can look kind of like a sulfur or a pink color because of the light pollution and the snow. It's very can be a little unnerving.
Yeah, but that's interesting too. Like I wonder, like say with the plants, like you know how much that impacts their daily. I mean, like you were talking about the heat islands, but also I wonder if some of that light pollution would also potentially impact them.
Yeah, I mean it would probably depend on the species, but all of these factors impact.
Yeah, I mean, something from as simple as, you know, are different species up and about that would be feeding on them because it's light out versus it being dark that would have given them, you know, time to, like, you know, not be eaten or whatever else. I mean, you could take that so many different ways to see, like, how that could impact them. So.
And recently, I know at least in New York City, they've been replacing a lot of our streetlights with LED lights that are like daylight bulbs. They're like 6,500 Kelvin bulbs. So essentially plant lights, and they are right over street trees and the street tree pits. And I have thought about, I noticed them mostly because one's outside my window and it literally is like day at nighttime. Yeah. I have to like close the blinds. But, you know, is that a good thing or a bad thing? You can argue both ways. You know, the plant is getting additional light, but the plant also does need to do things in the dark.
Yeah, because it's not going to grow if it's not having that respiration at night.
Yeah, yeah. So the increased light may actually be, over time, taxing to the street tree population. We'll have to see whether that would be an interesting study for a budding scientist to look at maybe 5 years from now to see what the street tree populations look like in these new LED situations.
Yeah, that would be really cool to read. I would read that study. Yeah. So yeah, if you want to get into botany, there you go.
Yes.
Find an advisor that will, like, you know, take you on for that project.
That's
so
right.
Have fun with that. Well, I think we're just about out of time here. So if you have any questions, feel free to send them along to the Scicomm Monday Twitter handle or my personal handle at WildlifeBioGal, and then make sure you're also following along with the Rutgers NJIT Scicomm hashtag for all the events for the rest of the day. We'll be back on Periscope at, let me make sure I get this right, at 2:45 p.m. so in a couple hours, and we'll be talking with Nicole Dykstra about her work for her PhD. So thank you very much for being on here. I hope you had a lot of fun.
It was great. Thanks for having
so
me.
I hope you all enjoyed it, and we'll see you guys later this afternoon. Have a good one.
Bye.